Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to be here. And again, I thank Dr. Guillermo Dominguez-Cherit for this kind of invitation. It's not the first one. I will try to do my best to convince you to use responsiveness indices
to
guide fleet management.
Para guiar manejo.
So my talk will
ahora,
be about,
mi plática se va a referir de lo que, a lo que hemos aprendido en los últimos años en cuanto a respuesta a terapia hídrica. Aquí están mis conflictos de interés. Ahora, primero voy a definir lo que es respuesta a terapia hídrica. Se define como la capacidad del corazón para aumentar significativamente su volumen por latido o gasto cardíaco en respuesta a un desafío de volumen. Para entenderlo, tengo que ir a recurrir a la fisiología básica. Es una de las diapositivas del tema, la relación de Frank Sterling de volumen por latido en el eje de las abscisas y precarga ventricular en el eje de las X.
The shape is not clear.
Como saben, la forma es curvilínea, no es clara, queriendo decir que si se aumenta la carga ventricular administrando líquidos, el ventrículo estará trabajando en esta parte de ascenso de la curva de Frank-Starling y el volumen por latido aumenta. Esta condición se denomina respuesta
if you increase preload,
líquidos. Si se aumenta la precarga con líquidos, por ejemplo, ya que está el ventrículo trabajando en la parte plana, no hay ningún aumento en volumen por latido. A esto se le llama falta de respuesta de precarga.
Of course,
ahora, por supuesto, la infusión de líquidos va a aumentar el volumen por latido ventricular izquierdo solo si ambos ventrículos.
So fluid responsiveness, which is a clinical concept, is equivalent to biventricular preload responsiveness, which is a physiological concept. So what have we learned about this topic over the past 20 years, I would say. Five things, 5 points. The first one is that not every patient with acute aortic failure is fluid responsive. There are many studies looking at the response to fluids in terms of hemodynamics, in terms of increasing cardiac output. And this is a review of the literature we published many years ago with my colleague, Frédéric Richard. And when we look at the literature at that time, we were surprised that among 400 patients with shock, 48% of them did not increase their cardiac output in response to fluid administration. And it was new at that time. So half of the patients do not respond to fluid administration. Why in the ICU? Why in shock? Second point, fluid loading in unresponsive patients may favor pulmonary edema and may decrease oxygen delivery. May favor pulmonary edema. I showed you the Frank-Starling curve, which is a systolic function of the ventricle. The left as well as the right ventricle. Now look at the left ventricle. We also have the diastolic function curve, with preload on the x-axis and left ventricular endothelial pressure on the x-axis. Now consider the situation of unresponsiveness. You have this curve, and if you give fluid, if you increase preload while the patient is fluid unresponsive, not only you do not increase cardiac output, this is the definition of unresponsiveness, but you increase a lot the left ventricular endothelial pressure with a high risk of pulmonary edema because there is a high risk of increase in the capillary pressure in the lungs. So this is a second penalty. In fluid unresponsive patients, you do not increase cardiac output and you have a high risk of creating pulmonary edema. But there is a third penalty. If you give fluid to a patient, you create hemodilution. You decrease hemoglobin concentration. So in case of fluid unresponsiveness, cardiac output does not increase. As you know, oxygen delivery depends a lot on hemoglobin concentration and cardiac output. And therefore, in this kind of patients, oxygen delivery decreases. And this is what we found in this paper we did in our institution. Decrease in oxygen delivery in patients who were not fluid responsive. This is not the goal of resuscitation, to decrease oxygen delivery. So we have to be very, very careful about this concept of fluid unresponsiveness. Only fluid responders increase oxygen delivery due, of course, to the increase in cardiac output. So keep in mind that in fluid non-responders, there is a high risk of decrease in oxygen delivery. Number three, excessive fluid administration may cause harm, maybe due to the previous point. And there is a lot of papers showing that a positive fluid balance is associated with mortality. This is a paper by Jean-Louis Vincent and co-workers, the SOAP study published years ago in septic patients, showing that a positive cumulative fluid balance was an independent factor associated with mortality. Also, in RDS patients, with my colleagues, Mathieu Josviak and Xavier Monet, we also found that a positive cumulative fluid balance is an independent factor associated with mortality. So we have to be very careful about fluid administration. Number four, because of number one, plus number two, plus number three, prediction of fluid responsiveness is very important to prevent fluid loading in patients who are fluid unresponsive. So how to do, how to predict? Number five, we also learned that static measures of preload cannot reliably predict fluid responsiveness. Why? Simply because of physiology. I showed you before a Frank Starling curve, but in fact, there is not one single Frank Starling curve, but a family of curves between a normal heart and a failing heart. A family of curves depending on the contractility of the patient. And therefore, if you measure preload accurately with any of the markers of preload, this value of preload can be associated with fluid responsiveness in case of normal heart or unresponsiveness in case of failing heart. So you cannot predict from a single value of preload that the patient will increase or not his cardiac output in response to fluid administration. Assessing preload is not assessing preload responsiveness, and static measures of preload cannot reliably predict fluid responsiveness. And this was demonstrated in many studies. This is one of them coming from my unit with David Osman. We measure POP, the wedge pressure using a PA catheter, and CVP in patients before giving fluids. And we defined afterwards fluid responders and fluid non-responders in function of the response of cardiac output. As you can observe on this slide, there was no difference between responders and non-responders in terms of baseline values of POP or CVP, which are cardiac filling pressures. And this was confirmed in many other studies. This is a meta-analysis, including 1,800 patients, 43 studies that look at the prediction of fluid responsiveness using CVP, central venous pressure. And they found, Marik and co-workers found, a summary area under the rocker for the prediction of fluid responsiveness of 0.56, which is exactly like tossing a coin. So it's not possible from a value of CVP to predict the response to fluid administration. And this was confirmed for any other markers of preload. This is another study we did with echocardiography, and we measure some markers of filling pressures, E over EA ratio, and left ventricular aortic area index, so markers of preload, and we define responders and non-responders according to the response of cardiac output to fluid administration. And before giving fluids, we did not observe any difference between these markers of preload in responders versus non-responders. Again, we cannot use this kind of indices to predict responsiveness. Also for BNP, you know that BNP is a biological marker of preload, as you know, and there is no difference between responders and non-responders using a baseline value of BNP before giving fluids to patients. Number six, dynamic tests or dynamic variables are reliable to predict fluid responsiveness. And now, many societies, international societies, recommend to use dynamic variables to predict fluid responsiveness. The consensus conference report coming from the European Society of Intensive Care Medicine, as well as the Surviving Sepsis Campaign guidelines. But what is a dynamic variable? If we refer to the Frank-Starling curve again, I like this relationship. A dynamic variable is something which can quantify the slope of the curve at the time you decide to give a treatment to your patient. If you have the slope, you have the answer of your question. Is my patient fluid responsive or not? But to have a slope, we need 2 points. So we need to change preload and to look at the change in stroke volume or cardiac output at the same time. So we have two categories of dynamic variables, heart-lung interaction indices and passive leg raising tests. What about heart-lung interaction indices? In fact, these indices are usable only in patients who receive mechanical ventilation, of course. And the idea behind is that the more the cardiac output or the stroke volume changes with mechanical ventilation, the more likely the patient is preload responsive. And for this, we have different indices. We have the respiratory variation of stroke volume during mechanical ventilation, pulse pressure variation, PPV, or stroke volume variation, SVV. PPV, you know, this is very simple index, which requires only an atrial catheter to be obtained. And PPV is the difference between the maximal value of pulse pressure minus the minimal value of pulse pressure divided by the mean of the two values. Pulse pressure, of course, is the difference between the systolic and the diastolic pressure. Very simple. And when we have a high PPV, we can assume that the heart of the patient is functioning on the preload-responsive part of the Frank-Starling curve. When we have a low PPV, we can assume the opposite. And this hypothesis was confirmed in this study published years ago, almost 20 years ago now. And with my colleagues, we compare the prediction of fluid responsiveness using PPV and using centrifugal pressure, CVP, and using POP measured by a PA catheter. As you can observe, the raw curve and the area under the raw curve is far better, far larger for PPV. And this was confirmed by many other studies. This is a meta-analysis coming from China, including 22 studies and 800 patients. All these patients were mechanically ventilated with a tidal volume of at least 8 ml per kilogram. As you can observe, the summary area under the raw curve was good, 0.94, and the threshold value was 12%. In other terms, if you have a PPV higher than 12, probably the patient will respond to fluid administration, and the opposite was true. Now, it's possible to have the value of PPV automatically calculated and displayed in real time by many hemodynamic monitors. Also, it is possible from some monitors to derive stroke volume from the atrial pressure waveform analysis. And you also can have stroke volume variation from these monitors. And SVV, stroke volume variation, also was demonstrated to be good to predict responsiveness. Another possibility is to use the variation during mechanical ventilation of the plethysmographic signal using a simple pulse oximeter. And this is a meta-analysis by the group of Massimo Antonelli from Rome in Italy, showing that the area under the raw curve for the prediction of responsiveness using this respiratory variation of the plethysmographic signal was good, 0.85 in this study, but not perfect, not as good as for PPV. Probably because many of these patients receive vasopressors. This is a paper we published years ago with my colleagues, Xavier Monet and others, and we look at the prediction of field responsiveness using PPV, SVV, and PVI. PVI for plate variability index. It is a respiratory variation of the plethysmographic signal. As you can observe in patients who receive norepinephrine, it's not as good as PPV and SVV. Also, we can use the respiratory variation of the inferior vena cava diameter. It is simple, non-invasive, and in this paper we published years ago now with Mark Fessel, we showed that the variation of the inferior vena cava diameter can predict field responsiveness in mechanically ventilated patients ventilated with at least 8 ml per kilogram tidal volume. And we found a threshold value of 12% to distinguish between responders and non-responders. But, I repeat, but there are many limitations to use these indices, pulse pressure variation, stroke volume variation, and all the others. Because in many conditions encountered in ICU patients, we cannot use these indices. We cannot use in case of arrhythmias. We cannot use these indices in case of low tidal volume ventilation, in case of spontaneous breathing activity. It's not possible. This is a very, very big limitation, spontaneous breathing activity, but also tidal volume. This is why we have other tests using heart-lung interaction. One of them is the end-expiratory occlusion test. The hypothesis is that during each mechanical insufflation, you should have a decrease in the sweet turn. So if you stop the ventilator at the end of expiration, just before the next insufflation, you should have a transient increase in venous sweet turn and preload, and this is like a preload challenge. And therefore, you can identify field responders by looking at the response of cardiac output during this very brief challenge, only 15 seconds. Very simple to do because you have just to press a button for 15 seconds, and you look at the response. But you need a cardiac output monitor to do this. You need a cardiac output monitor, real-time cardiac output monitor. And using the PICO here and the pulse contour cardiac output with my colleagues, we show that patients who will respond to fluid administration later on, in blue, also had an increase in cardiac output during the test, performed before fluid administration, of course. And patients who will not respond to fluid administration in red also did not increase cardiac output during the test. So we can well identify this kind of patients. It is easy to do. And it works well in patients with ARDS and low compliance of the respiratory system. In this study, we did in our unit, we compared pulse pressure variation and this index spiratory occlusion test. And as you can observe, the raw curve is larger, far larger, for the index spiratory occlusion test. The problem is that using this test, we have 5% as cutoff value, very low. It is a very low value. And it is good for pulse contour analysis because the precision of pulse contour analysis is very good, but maybe less for echocardiography. Because we know that for echocardiography variables, the least significant change for velocity time integral is around 10%. So 10% is above 5%. And in this study we published very recently, 2 months ago, with Mathieu Josiak, we look at the precision of all the echocardiographic variables. As you can observe for velocity time integral, which is a marker of stroke volume, if you use only one operator, the least significant change is 11%. If you use two operators, the least significant change is 14%. So it is difficult to use this index spiratory occlusion test if you look at the changes with echocardiography. This is why recently we proposed to combine the index spiratory occlusion test and the inspiratory occlusion test in order to have a threshold value more compatible with the precision of echocardiography. I will skip this. And finally, this is what we found. When we combine and when we add the absolute change in cardiac output during first and expiratory occlusion test, then an inspiratory occlusion test, we have a cutoff value of 13%, which now is more compatible with the precision of echocardiography. So if you use echocardiography for this inspiratory occlusion test, it is better to combine with an inspiratory occlusion test. And we found same results in a paper more recently published using esophageal Doppler instead of echo. In some patients with low tidal volume, it is interesting to perform a tidal volume challenge. Indeed, if you use a tidal volume of 6 ml per kilogram, pulse pressure variation cannot work very well. In this study with Sheila Mayatra from India, we showed that the area under the curve using PPV at 6 ml per kilogram is not good. 0.71 is not acceptable. Many false positives and false negatives. But if we increase tidal volume for 1 minute from 6 to 8 ml per kilogram now, we have a better area under the raw curve, and the change from 6 to 8 perform very well to predict fluid responsiveness. If you have a change of pulse pressure variation more than 3.5%, you can predict fluid responsiveness. I can take an example. If you have a PPV of 7%, at 6 ml per kilogram, you increase tidal volume for 1 minute. Now, if PPV goes up to 11%, you can be almost sure that the patient is really responsive. If PPV goes up from 7 to 9%, you are almost sure that the patient is not fully responsive. So it's very simple to do, but of course there is only one study. We need further confirmation. Some words about it happened to me. I was in London, UK, and I gave a very complicated talk about physiology of heart-lung interaction. Very complicated talk, and after 10 slides, everything crashed. And I gave my talk a cappella, without slides. It was terrible. Because there was no direct clinical implication, so it was very physiologic and very difficult for people to understand. There's no slide. Fortunately, also the chronometer stopped. It's the good news. If you want, I can say something about passive leg raising without slides. You know this maneuver. How many of you use this maneuver? Passive leg raising. This is very simple. It consists in moving the bed of the patient, not the patient, but the bed of the patient from the semi-recumbent position, which is a natural position in the ICU, to a position where the legs are elevated at 45 degrees and the trunk and the head are horizontal. And this maneuver is able to shift venous blood from the legs compartment and from the abdominal compartment towards the intrathoracic compartment. This is a volume challenge. This is a preload challenge. This is a way to quantify the slope of the Frank Starling curve. But of course, we need a real-time cardiac output monitor because the effects are very transient. But it is like a free challenge, but no fluid is infused. And the effects are totally reversible. There is no risk of pulmonary edema. And this works very well. You see? I can continue to speak about passive leg raising. So it is a very simple test. You need a real-time cardiac output monitor because the effects are very transient. You cannot use thermodilution, for example. You need to use either pulse contour analysis or echocardiography, esophageal Doppler, any real-time cardiac output monitor. Unfortunately, you cannot use the atrial pressure. You cannot. You can if you want, but it is less valid. And in a meta-analysis we performed, we showed that the changes in cardiac output can very well predict full responsiveness with a good area under the row curve. So I will continue rapidly my presentation. Maybe, yes. So I told you it can increase preload. And this is a paper we published years ago with Thierry Boulin. We looked at the changes in the right atrial pressure in the POP during PLR. And in almost all patients, cardiac filling pressures increased, and after finishing the test, returned to baseline. It is reversible. There is no risk of pulmonary edema. So it mimics the challenge and no fluid is infused. You need to look at the response to PLR by using a cardiac output monitor, a real-time cardiac output monitor. This is very important. And you can use whatever you want, provided that this is a real-time cardiac output monitor. This is the meta-analysis we published 3 years ago. We included 21 clinical studies, almost 1,000 patients, so it's not nothing. And the changes in cardiac output very well predicted through responsiveness. The area under the row curve was 0.95, and fortunately, we found a threshold value of 10%. I said fortunately because it is simple to remember. And now it is It is recommended by the Surviving Sepsis Campaign Guidelines, so I'm very proud of that. Number 7, protocols using dynamic tests are associated with improved outcome. This is a meta-analysis published 2 years ago, looking at all the randomized clinical trials, comparing strategies using CVP to strategies using dynamic variables, either PPV or SVV or passive leg raising. As you can observe, the outcome, mortality as well as morbidity, were better when you use dynamic tests compared to static measures like CVP. So this is a confirmation that it works very well. Number 8, testing pre-responsiveness is not advised for initiating IV fluids in shock states, at the beginning of the story, I mean. Given that hypovolemia is present in 90% of shock states and 100% in septic shock, it is logical to infuse a fluid bolus early without using any predictor of fluid responsiveness. I would say be smart. Of course, it is better to be smart, but not too much. And don't waste time, too much time. Number 9, presence of pleural responsiveness is mandatory to decide to continue fluid infusion after the first fluid bolus. And the decision of continuing fluid infusion, of course, should be based on the persistence of hemodynamic instability plus the presence of pleural responsiveness plus limited risk of fluid overload. And number 10, the presence of pleural unresponsiveness now is sufficient to decide to stop fluid infusion. And the decision to stop should be based on either disappearance of hemodynamic instability or now presence of pleural unresponsiveness or high risk of fluid overload. And you can look at blood gases, you can look at extracellular water or pulmonary vascular permeability index if you use a transformate hemodilution device, etc. So you stop either if shock disappears, of course, or if the patient becomes fluid unresponsive, or if there is a high risk of pulmonary edema and fluid overload. These are the 10 points I wanted to highlight. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias.